It's good to make a point of praying before you come to the meetings.
Yes.
For the environment and for the participation and whoever speaks. And I'm growing more and more persuaded that more can actually happen in the assembly as we are more prepared. And there's some preparations that have to be done off-site, so to speak.
Yeah.
And we welcome those on live stream also. You've noticed a little change in the agenda where we're going to have our prayer session after we've had the lesson. We're in the Gospel of John. This will be installment number 34 in the exposition of this book. We're going to be in John 3, 18 and 19. You probably have noticed by this time the richness of the third chapter of John. It's phenomenal. I think that the necessity of believing on or believing in Christ has been grossly understated in our time. There's too shallow of a view that's common. I'm talking about the common. Too shallow of a view. Even though there are a number of rather astounding statements made about believing on or believing in Christ. I'll just give you a few of them here. Ponder what is said about the one who believes on or in Christ. He that believeth on him is not condemned. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. He that believeth on me shall never thirst. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. He that believeth me believeth not on me, but on him that sent me. He that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto the Father. He that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? He that believeth on the Son of God hath a witness in himself. You see how weighty.
Yes, amen.
Those statements are, and every one of them are things that are attractive to the person who is seeking the Lord. He wants the benefits as mentioned. They're all tied to believing on Christ.
Amen.
So believing on Christ, in a sense, it stands by itself. Or to maybe more accurate, it is the key to everything. Yes. Everything else. See, any religious system that claims association with Christ yet fails to emphasize the ongoing necessity of believing in Christ, this system is spurious.
Yes, amen.
You know, it's spurious.
Yeah.
No credit at all can be given to it.
Yeah.
Because a theological stance that has holes in it, nothing good can be said about it.
Yes.
You gotta really see this. Mm-hmm. It's got to be rejected because of the holes. Because
yeah. Uh-huh.
A theology that cannot hold together will cause you, that theology will cause you to fall.
Yeah. Amen.
And I should not be surprised if a lot of backsliding is owing more to erroneous theology than to the pressures of the world. Now you have to kind of think about that. The less necessary Jesus is to a body of teaching, the more flawed and false it is.
Yes.
Now all of God's favorable dealings with men are filtered through Christ.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yes, amen.
All of them.
That's right.
Everything that men offer to God is through Christ. So this, if that's all we knew, we deduced that we can't embrace anything that minimizes Christ himself. there has been false Christs, mm-hmm. and other Jesuses have been introduced.
Yeah. Yeah.
They are not presented as false Christs. Mm-hmm. They're presented as though they were the real Christs mm-hmm. and the real Jesus, but they are not. And none of the things that Jesus said occurs when you believe in him. None of them occur under these systems.
Mm-hmm.
Unless the person has, apart from the system, mm-hmm. believed in Christ.
Yeah.
See, an erroneous approach to a disciplined spiritual life, like the church at Ephesus had, and we're commended for having it, isn't it? That approach is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
But it allowed them to leave their first love, which put them in jeopardy of being cut off from Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's how important Jesus is, brother.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
So now we will look at these two verses, John 3, verses 18 and 19. He that believeth on him is not condemned. He that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil.
Yes, amen.
Yeah. Now you know why people are.
Yes.
Now, what does it mean to believe on him? That's the first mm-hmm. thing I had to. My own spirit had to grasp. He that believeth on him. Some other versions state it this way. Believes in him. Or has faith in him. Or trusts in him. Now I give these to you to show you that men have sensed that work with this, that there's a lot in this. So that's why they have these different, it's a big, big thought. Trust in him, who trust him to save them, who commits himself to Jesus, trusting in him, has faith in God's Son, or who clings to, trusts in, and relies on him. The interlinear version, that's the literal translation, rough translation from the Greek language to the English. And one of the English versions read, whosoever believeth into him.
Mm-hmm.
And I looked, and the word does mean that. That's accurate. The word used here mm-hmm. does mean that. Into whoever believes into Christ. Now the point here is not on intellectual assent.
Yeah. Yeah.
I agree. Uh-huh. That's not what we're talking about here. Or I don't see anything wrong with that. See, that's not what it means.
Yeah.
I'm willing to accept that. You know, that's not what this means.
Uh-huh.
This is deeper than that.
Yeah.
Elsewhere, John equates believing on his name with receiving him.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Here's how he stated it in John 1:12. As many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. So that's what receive, that's what believing on his name means. You receive him. See, so it's not a mere activity of the mind.
That's right.
Concerning believing on Christ, it's also written, for this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because that when ye received the word of God, which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth the word of God, which uh-huh. effectually worketh also in you that believe. So here, see,
amen.
People that believe, God's word works,
yes, amen.
Produces in them.
That's
what
right.
can't be produced
yes.
otherwise.
Amen.
See, so now we're seeing a little more clearly. Peter told those at the house of Cornelius, to him give all the prophets witness that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive the remission of sin. See that? Oh, that's too hard for people I once trafficked among. That's what Peter said. This was Peter the apostle. This wasn't like someone giving their opinion. Whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. You say, well, but that doesn't, that believing's not, he said exactly what he meant. Let's not be playing games with the word of God here. Right. Saying, yeah, but the Bible also says over here if we do this and if over here if we do that. Your job is not to put text together. God puts texts together. God is the one who puts thoughts together. And when addressing that kind of subject, he makes a statement about it. That's not what is doing. You don't want to impose those texts on this text. You've got to accept this text just as it stands, period. And then God will integrate it someplace else. He'll integrate it with other responses of humanity. There's also divine activity in believing that show you why such a strong statement can be made, see? It is also given to you to believe on him. See, and I also, then the one who gives you to believe, he can make statements like this.
That's right.
Because this believing is not a mere human activity. Believing is just not something men do. Mm-hmm. It's something men are directed and empowered to do.
Amen. That's right.
That's why a statement like this can be made. If we believe on him, the imputation of righteousness, what a gigantic subject that is. Here's what he says concerning the imputation of righteousness, to whom it shall be imputed if we believe on him that raised up Jesus, our Lord, from the dead.
Amen.
You say, well, is it possible to believe on Jesus and this not happen? No. It is not possible to believe on Jesus and God not do this.
Amen. That's right. Yes.
If it looks like it's possible, the person didn't believe. It's just it's just that cut and dried, brethren.
Yeah.
Mm. And secondly, of course, this isn't given for us to diagnose other people.
That's right.
You understand? This is not a ruler that you settle on everybody else. This you measure yourself by this. Believing on him describes everything that's involved in being added to the Lord and living on, abiding in him and living unto him, and believing is encompassed in all of that.
Yes.
Now, as I've indicated before, the word believeth is the old English way of saying it, is in the active mode, the language where we call it present indicative active. It's something that is going on now. Mm-hmm. Believeth doesn't mean when you first believe.
Mm-hmm.
It's something going on right now. This is something I want to labor to establish, that when the Word of God makes promises to someone who believes, he's not talking about who believed back then somewhere. They did believe back then somewhere. But these statements made about faith is if people that are in the process now of believing and trusting.
Amen.
That's what I'm going to seek to establish. This is not, I believed. This is not a step in a plan of salvation that you fulfilled and moved on to the next step. It's not what he's talking about. If that's what men are talking about, they're talking about something God doesn't talk about.
Yeah.
They're trying to defend their position. They're not trying to expound the Word of God. Because they're different plans of salvation, as you know.
Yes.
The group that I was associated with had 5 steps. The full gospel businessmen had 6 steps. And there's all these groups they have. Some have 1 step, sinner's prayer. You know, they.
Yeah.
But believing is not a step. It's something that in this believing, you add all those virtues Paul mentioned about knowledge, temperance, godliness, and so forth. Yes?
I might say that believing is engaging the divine, engaging with God himself.
Yes, very good. Amen.
Amen.
So this is referring to a person who is believing, who is relying on Christ. That's what they're doing. Who is depending on Christ, who is living for Christ. It's the person in whom Jesus is living and who to whom Jesus is revealing himself or manifesting himself, as he said, promised. Now, it's good to remember when we believed.
Yes.
Our salvation is nearer than when we believe. See, it's good to remember when we started believing. Although you'll find it difficult to pinpoint that.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah, that's right.
You'll find it difficult to pinpoint when you first believed. It'll be kind of general. At least that's how I found it.
Yeah.
And I think this is like on purpose.
Yeah.
I think God arranged it this way because he knows that men are prone to fasten their hopes on something when it started, but in Christ, you're not to trust in when it started.
Yeah.
It's if it continues.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's right.
That's the point. Well, what about a person that believe on him? He that believeth on him, that is believing on him, he's not condemned.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
As I say, he's not. Now, the not condemned doesn't refer to in the future. It refers to right now.
Amen.
I don't know that you can have an unwavering confidence that you will not be condemned. It will always be conditioned by if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the Lord.
Yeah.
So the important thing to you is, are you condemned now? You have to have that assurance now.
Yeah.
Temptations are now. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, I thought about that same thing we brought up many times about when did I really believe. But, you know, I thought about that God had removed any chance that you might assign something that you did to it.
That's right.
Because, you know, God
that's
gives
good.
Us to
yes.
believe. And was I just a kid? Was I 19? When was it? You know, so, but, you
yeah.
know, somewhere along the line, though, God, you know, gave you to believe, but you sort of had to kind of catch up to it.
That's right. You're right.
Yeah, I thought connecting with that too. I have no problem in the flesh that I don't know at the exact point that my mother conceived me. I have no idea.
Yeah.
She probably doesn't even know the exact moment. So, I mean, I accept that. Just I know when I was born.
Yeah.
But see, the conception, now the Holy Spirit's been working with you a long
that's
time
right.
before you were born.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen. It's like Cornelius.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
We don't how long. We don't have no idea how long.
Mm-hmm.
We've been serving God with prayers and for some time. It may have been years. I don't know, but for some time he's been doing it.
Yeah.
He is not condemned. Now, some of the versions, they kind of managed to garble this up.
Yeah.
One of the greatest enemies of sound learning is a Greek lexicon.
Mm.
Boy, they can really foul you up. I know, I got plenty of them. Is not condemned. All right, here's some of the other versions. The New American Standard is not judged. Does not come up to be judged. Basic Bible English. The Christian Standard Bible. Are not judged. New Jerusalem Bible. No one who believes in him will be judged. New Living Translation. No judgment against anyone. Living Bible, there is no eternal doom waiting. Weymouth says, does not come up for judgment, as well as William's Bible. No one who believes in him has to come up for judgment. Goodspeed. Message Bible says, is acquitted. Amplified Bible says, he who trusts in him never comes up for judgment. See, many of those, they're just wrong. These are wrong translations. Nobody is exempted from judgment.
He
is appointed unto man once to die, and after this, the judgment. Nobody's excluded from either one of those. The death, the only ones are those who are alive and remain, and then they're going to be separated from their body, go through it instantly, what happens in death. So there's too much about this being judged in Scripture. There's too much about it. You see, the lexicon says judgment is one. If you were to say judgment against, all right, that would be proper, but that's not what they not what they say. The Word of God makes clear that we are everyone's going to be judged. Jesus is going to judge everyone. We must all stand for the judgment seat of Christ. The dead are going to be raised, all the seas going to give up the dead, and their books are going to be opened to everybody. Is going to be judged. So condemned is the proper, more clear word here. Further, it also is in the present tense. Is not, not will not, is not.
Amen.
See, I can understand why this has to be. You've got to know while you're living, you have to know what your status is to live successfully.
Amen.
You can't live always projecting up until when Jesus comes and the day of judgment. If you live, you don't know when that's going to be, and you have to include that in your thinking. I understand, but you've got to know about right now. It's good before you go to sleep to know that you know this status.
Amen. Yes.
Am I or am I not condemned? Don't assume you're not condemned. Don't assume you're not. Look for the evidence. Am I trusting? Am I depending on him? Am I relying upon him? Who am I living for?
Yeah, praise God.
Now, you'll not be satisfied with your life. I understand this. But you'd be satisfied enough to know you're not condemned. The one who's believing on Christ is, the one who is believing on Christ is not condemned. God's not against.
That's
right. So what calamity comes, some member of the family's life is taken, some tragedy occurs. See, the person who knows this, well, this isn't because God's against me.
Amen.
See?
Yeah.
Got to be able to reason like Job did.
Yes.
You can have a full assurance of hope if you know this. You're not condemned. In confirmation of this present not condemned status, apostolic doctrine says there is therefore now, there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. See, now you want to get a hold of that. Don't just make that a theological position. I don't know that any of you do, but I know that there are pressures for you to do this. There are religious pressures to make you think like this. Well, I'm not condemned, so kind of let your
No.
What happens is when you really know you're not condemned, you put the whole armor on and you take the weaponry and see you engage the forces of principalities and powers. When you know, those who are living by faith, implicitly relying on Christ, are assured. Now you've been made accepted in the beloved. And God doesn't condemn the people he accepts.
Amen.
God condemns the people he rejects. Now, because men have structured flawed views of no condemnation, they have lived more loosely than even they know they should live. but they relied on not being condemned without evidence. Yeah. And believing is the evidence. Yeah. Believing. Active. Our believing, that's the evidence. It is, there was a time when we first believed, but that was the beginning of newness of life. That wasn't the whole thing. That was the beginning. And believing goes all the way up to the culmination.
Amen.
When you move out of the body. Mm-hmm. See, that's going to be the culmination. He that believeth on him is not condemned. Oh, what a thing to give thanks for.
Yes, amen.
But he that believeth not is condemned already. Mm-hmm. He just is again. We're talking about right now.
Yes.
This is not talking about the scope of life or down there sometime. This is right now. You have to live life a day at a time, or even a moment. Mm-hmm. Moment at a time. This is how you live. And every moment, you want to target every moment to have this kind of persuasion. He that believeth not is condemned already. Now, the gravity or the weight of the text is seen in the fact we're talking about condemnation. So this is... This isn't talking about like having a bad day. I mean, this isn't talking like that. This isn't talking about just chastening.
Yeah, uh-huh.
Condemnation, we're talking about. It should strike the fear into the heart of everyone who's casual about life.
Yes, amen.
When you get to kind of loping through life casually, you got to be concerned about condemnation, because you're in a mode that leads to condemnation. He that believeth not. Now again, this is something that's going on now. Mm-hmm. Some other verses read, he does not believe, those who do not believe, who has no faith in him, does to commit himself to Jesus and so forth. Notice this text is not an assessment of the past. Mm-hmm. Did not believe. Mm-hmm. Do not believe. That's what he's talking about. The appraisal of the present. Now there is an approach to, for want of a better term, Christianity, that never provokes people to assess really whether or not they are believing. There's an approach that kind of anesthetizes you, so you don't even think about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, I've been baptized.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, I remember when I thought this way when I was younger. I remember. But see, that's, you don't build your faith on that.
Yeah, right.
Not at all. There was a time when we trusted in the Lord. Mm-hmm. We first trusted in Christ. That's Ephesians 1:12. When we first trusted in Christ. And we recall that with joy. But this is not the believing of reference in our text. That's not the believing he's talking about. This is the believing to which Hebrews 10:39 refers, 10:38 and 39. We are not of them who draw back to perdition,
that's right,
but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. So that's all.
Yeah.
That believe to the saving of the soul doesn't mean that the objective is to save the soul.
Mm-hmm.
It means the believing fills in from here to when the soul is completely saved. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Believe to the saving of the soul. Some verses say the preservation of the soul. A believing person will not allow something to interrupt believing into the...
Yeah.
I mean, it's one thing to be believing when you're in the king's court. It's another to be believing when you're in the fiery furnace.
That's right.
Yeah. That's something else.
Uh-huh. Amen.
It's one thing to be believing when you're in the presence of the king interpreting his dream. It's another thing to be believing when you're in the lion's den.
That's right. Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
But see, believing takes you through all of those attempted diversions.
Amen.
See, why did God allow those men to be thrown into a fiery furnace, because he knew that he could make them stand there. And he knew, they knew he could make him stand there, see? Why doesn't everybody go through that? Because God also knows some people can't stand through that. They're weak. There's some people God has to make stand. You know, they're stand in spite of their religious views. Because they basically see Christ right, but they just don't see enough of him. They just see his left hand, you know, or something like that. They don't see him clearly. The believing keeps a person from losing his own soul. Mm-hmm. Not be willing to exchange. Mm-hmm. What will a man give in exchange for his soul? See, the world will offer you some things if you just quit being so religious. Yeah. They'll offer you something. Mm-hmm. But believing to the saving of the soul moves the person to reject all those pleas. Yeah. Those who are justified, they do. They live by faith. Mm-hmm. Yes?
I was thinking about this believing and why trials are so important. I mean, we think, why does the Lord give us trials? But these trials strengthen our faith.
That's right.
And so we're able to continue to believe. I mean, so it's really for the saving of our soul, these trials are.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Exactly. The just shall live by faith. See, life as God views life can't be maintained independently of believing. Mm-hmm. Believing is, I think Sister Barbara alluded to, the umbilical cord. Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is the thing that connects you with God.
That's right.
And causes you to live. Those who are justified by faith, they live by faith.
That's right.
The just shall.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean might. It shall live by faith. Yes, Brother Justin, Jason.
It seems to me that the assurance comes when you're actually focused on Christ. When you're
Amen.
You could put yourself in kind of a state where you're always questioning your faith. You're always saying,
yes,
"Am I believing? Am I maybe I'm not believing? Am I believing enough? Maybe I could believe more."
See,
this will drive you batty.
The
point is the object of the faith.
That's right.
So when you have assurance, when you're fully trusting in Christ, that's the assurance.
Amen.
Like the song says, I think it's the song Power in the Blood. He says, are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Yes. Are you washed in the blood?
Yes, mm-hmm. Amen.
Are you fully trusting now?
Amen. Mm-hmm. See, the thing that will lead you to that is when your consideration of Christ is pleasant and good and assuring and doesn't produce questions. See, that will confirm to you that this is really believing.
Yes.
When you are drawn to Christ, see, you prefer him and you're willing to abandon other competing interests, this is telling you that your faith is genuine. Mm-hmm. But this is right. Brother Jace is right. That's the secret. It's focusing on Christ, mm-hmm. not focusing on what you should be.
Yeah.
See, you do consider this. You do consider, but you don't focus. You don't focus on this because you've got a part that has to be forced to serve God.
Yeah, that's right.
And if you think the fact that it has to be forced may mean that you don't have faith, see, this is a completely wrong conclusion. Can I keep under my body? I bring it into subjection.
Yes.
This didn't cause him to question if he believed or not. You say, well, we're kept by the power of God. Yeah, but we're kept by the power of God through faith.
That's right.
That's the keeping agent. This is what, when you believe, you earnestly contend for the faith.
Yeah.
You keep the faith. Mm-hmm. See, you don't depart from the faith. Mm-hmm. Why? Because believing is unusually satisfying and gratifying. When you have a strong faith, it like your soul just like quiets down.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Faith will actually enable or allow us to rest in the Lord.
Rest, amen.
Like Brother Jason was talking about, that's a lot of anxiety to carry around with you all the time,
mm-hmm.
trying to determine this kind of thing. But then if faith will allow you to rest, and you can just, that's resting.
That's right. See there, yes, Brother Jason.
I want to just add to that, because I was thinking about that myself, is I don't know if this is the best way to say this, but there's an objective and a subjective aspect of faith. The objective aspect of faith is there's some truth that we're embracing.
Mm-hmm.
We're saying we believe it's true that Jesus is the Son of God.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay? That's true. Even if I reject it, it's still true.
Yes.
Okay? So that's an objective thing. But subjectively, you have to rest in Christ.
Amen.
See?
Amen.
You have to lean the weight of your soul on Him. And all of our troubles with assurance comes when we're not able or willing to do that.
Mm-hmm.
When somehow we feel that maybe Jesus isn't sufficient. See, now that's when your assurance is gone.
Yes. Amen.
You know, Paul said, I know this is going to work out for my salvation. Now, he was resting in the
Lord.
He
was resting in it, yes. Leaning upon Him. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Amen.
You'll learn to do this in life. As you live by faith, you'll learn to do this. I can remember as a young man, how old was I? My real early 20s. And my life, as far as opportunities and that, fell apart. And society was such that there wasn't anything in society that I could feel adequate in, work or anything. It wasn't anything. And it was like a revelation. It came to me, well, I've got to be willing to trust in God, Christ, because He knows all the circumstances and I don't.
Mm-hmm.
He knows me, and I'm having trouble identifying me at this present time. And even when I came to realize that, it took everything I had to rely on Christ.
Mm-hmm.
It took everything I had, because there was all kind of voices shouting, as, come on now, that's not enough. You gotta get in there yourself and do it, you know. And but when you're walking on a stormy wave, you gotta learn to focus on Christ.
Amen.
Yes, Sister Barb.
The man that we speak about often, when he brought his son to the Lord's disciples for the casting out of the demon, I think this is what he was asking for.
That's right.
Whenever he said, Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief, he was asking to grow in this area.
Amen.
Because he had already encountered all kinds of obstacles for the reason he came that day.
Mm-hmm.
But when Jesus came, then it was like his opportunity to be able to grow in this area and to lay hold on what he came for that day.
Amen.
Amen.
See, the temptation is to say, it's true, but it's not for me.
That's
how you're going to be tempted. I don't think we're going to necessarily be tempted to say, I don't even believe there is a God anymore.
You're right.
I don't think we're going to be tempted to that. That's not what the shield of faith is the fiery darts that are like doubts to say that you're the exception.
That's right. Mm.
It's true for everybody else, but not for you.
Not for you. Your case.
That's a fiery dart. Not fiery dart's not, there is no God. I don't think that's a fiery dart.
Amen. You're right. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen. And the weaker a person is, the more prone he'll be thinking, I'm not qualified. This, I guess, can't be for me. And that's a dart from the devil. The devil's trying to persuade you that that's a valid thought, but it is not a valid thought, see?
Amen.
We have examples of this happen with Isaiah and Moses both. Isaiah said, I am a man of uncircumcised lips. And God said, go anyway. I think he put a coal to his lips, didn't he?
Or yeah,
something,
Isaiah,
something happened in the tabernacle or temple there. That happened too. And Moses also, he said, I can't do it. I'm not worthy. And he said, then I'll arrange so that you can.
Yeah.
This is no problem with God. If God is going to make His word be known through you, then that's what's going to get done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if God had presented leadership to Moses early on, he was able.
That's right.
He was a wise man and very eloquent, Stephen said. This is what he was in Egypt. But God didn't want him to trust in that Egyptian discipline. So he gave him sufficient time to dry that up. That happens to us too. sometimes we go through experiences that it dries up any lingering self-confidence that might be there. See, there are some people, very, very gifted people, and compared to other people, they rise above the multitudes. Very unusual people. But when it comes to salvation and confidence and full assurance, that's got to go. All that kind of confidence has to go.
Yes, amen.
The I can do it, that's got to go.
Uh-huh.
Now, what about those who are not believing? Incidentally, valid believing is always in the present tense.
That's right.
It's not considered in the historic sense.
Oh, the sense of the word believing makes me think about eternity. It's always now.
Yeah.
That's true.
Eternity. Mm-hmm.
That's true. That's true.
Like you're preparing to enter.
Faith transports you into that environment. That's right. Amen. Amen. So that when faith will become sight, when what you're aware of, you're fully cognizant of. Yeah.
It's been a key for me to grasp the truth about believing, to see that believing and faith really are synonyms. Is that faith is like noun form and believing is a verb form, or faith is possessed but believing is the action. And so you read through the scriptures and interchange the word faith and believing, and it always works. It never does sound strange, like walking by faith not by sight, or walking by believing not by sight. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith or our believing. It actually goes together.
Well, that's actually what he says there in verse 1. Yeah. Who is he? Mm-hmm. He says, faith overcomes the world. Who is he that believes?
That's right.
Jesus is the Son of God. Well, he says the person who is not believing, that's his stance. He is not trusting. I don't know if that describes you, but I can know whether it describes me.
Uh-huh.
And that's what it's written for. It's for self-examination, because you can't detect this in somebody else. You may think you've got flawless evidence that he is or he isn't, and then something will be done that will completely negate what you thought.
Yeah.
So this is for self-examination. Here's the person who is not believing is condemned already.
Yes.
Condemned already, has been judged already, the New American Standard says. Stand condemned already, the New NIV. Has been judged already, the American Standard. Has been judged even now, Basic Bible. See, judged again, this is not the proper word.
Uh-huh.
Condemned is the proper word.
Amen.
God will not look amiably upon anyone who's not leaning on Christ.
Amen. That's right.
You gotta believe that. See, but there's theologies that teach that this isn't so.
Mm-hmm.
They teach that even though a person's in an unbelief and they're walking at a distance from God and not living for God, God still accepts you. But see, this does not promote a holy life.
Amen.
Whether it's true or not isn't really the point. The point is, you can't live thinking you're all right when you're not.
Yeah. Amen.
That's a delusion.
Yes.
The word translated already, he's condemned already. The word means now, right now, presently, really. See, those who are properly classified as unbelievers, and that's a class of people. It's the class of people, the unbelievers.
Yeah.
Those who are properly classified unbelievers are in a condemned state.
Yeah, amen.
The reason for that is because natural man is at enmity with God. So the condemnation is not, it's not like God is condemning people who want to come to him.
No. Mm-hmm.
That's not the case. The condemnation is on people who are at enmity. They're at loggerheads with God.
Amen.
Now, when we believe, that enmity is done.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
You know, I can see, Brother Jason, that a lot of untaught people, some of whom I've known, have not seen this distinction you're talking about. They've looked at some little quirk in their character or life that they're with which they are fundamentally displeased, but they have thought it separated them from God. That's a devil. See, that the devil, he's wise.
Yeah.
He has devices.
Uh-huh. He's an accuser.
Yeah. Accuser.
All these things,
right,
that you're talking about, the fiery darts, it's a grace when the Lord gives us discernment to decipher what is conviction and what is an accusation.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Now, to more fully what unbelief is, as used here, is either the person has not obeyed the gospel, or they have departed from the faith. That's the kind of people that this is talking about here. It's a class of people, the unbelievers. They're not living by faith, they don't walk by faith, they're not standing by faith. See, they either never got in, or they did get in and they departed or fell away. That's the unbelievers. And he's condemned. Just think about it, he's condemned. Mm-hmm. You know, you'll see products, particularly in the industrial world. I was in the manufacturing part of the world, and some product couldn't be sold because it was deficient in some way, underweight or bad. So it was a sticker put on it that in effect said condemned, rejected, do not make available, you know, was condemned. There's people that are condemned. God won't use them. They don't have hope. Doesn't mean they can't have hope. They don't. See, that's in the present tense. It doesn't mean can't. Mm-hmm. It means doesn't.
Yeah.
There's quite a bit of difference. And why don't they? Why is this condition so? Because he hath not believed in the name. I like the way it says, believed in the name. The name is what God has declared him to be. When he says his name should be, all these names he was given, it was because that's what he was. His name is what God has said he is, ranged all the way from Savior to Shepherd to Mediator to Intercessor. That's what he is.
Amen.
To believe in his name is you trust him in those capacities.
Amen.
You trust him to lead you. And if you don't, then you seek guidance from somebody else.
Yeah, uh-huh.
Maybe a program, whatever. You trust him to do this.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't, maybe you depend on the preacher to take you through, see? Satan will try and get you to trust something else. Maybe a purpose or a plan or a name or whatever. No, person, he's condemned because he did not believe on the name, in the name. Who he was. They didn't trust that Jesus was who he's presented to be. Now there are a lot of people, it appears as though it's majority of professing Christians who do not have a good idea about who Jesus is. They don't really have a good idea about who God has declared Jesus is, what he's doing, what he has done, you know, and that's a little blurry to them. So that works toward that kind of posture lends itself to unbelief, see?
Jesus,
yes.
He's the only one that doesn't have to get a new name. I mean, who he is who he is.
Yeah. But he has a new name, but because
that's part of him
already.
That's
part of what he was after. Mm-hmm. When he was glorified as man, a glorified man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true.
This didn't contradict what he was. It made it, gave it utility for us. Yeah.
My understanding is that name also refers to like his position.
Yes.
Yeah.
He's the King of Kings.
Yes.
And Lord of Lords. That's his name.
That's mm-hmm. right.
That's a position that he occupies that God has given him.
Amen.
Amen.
See, in the world, a person can have a position but lack the power that goes along with it. You can't make things happen. If you say, for instance, you had a president that had power, like Pharaoh had power, he could make things happen. See, Jesus has that kind of power. He has not believed in the name. Now we must be careful not to think that salvation involves waffling back and forth between condemned and uncondemned. See, the people think this. I sin, now I'm condemned. I don't think my faith is strong enough, so that I'm condemned. See, this isn't how salvation is. You don't waffle back and forth between condemned, not condemned. And you've got to guard against thinking like this. Yeah. I know people who thought like this, and they found things in themselves that they knew shouldn't be there. They were discontent with him. They weren't repeatedly, it wasn't like overt, something they committed, but they thought they were condemned. They didn't think they could pray. They didn't think they could serve God. Salvation is not like that. Believing and not believing are things that become established. They're not something that happened in an instant. Now I'm believing, the next minute I'm not believing. See that? The way Jesus is using this word, this is not how these words are used. This is a state that's been developed and solidified. So he that doesn't believe is not someone that didn't believe that minute there, didn't think God could deliver him. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about continually. A person can't be weak in the faith, that doesn't mean they're unbelieving. Right? A person can be a child tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, that doesn't mean they're not believing. Unbelievers is a class of people. They're dominated by unbelief and they love to have it so. Yes.
I remember when I was ministering in churches, people every once in a while, people would come to me and I'm not sure if I'm really a Christian. Do you think they'd ask me kind of to give them something, you know? And I'd always tell them the fact that you're even bothered by the question indicates that you are a Christian.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Because if you weren't believing, you wouldn't care.
That's right.
You'd be completely dead.
Yeah. You're right. That's a great liberty for someone who's never seen it.
Yeah.
Well, I can remember when I first saw it, it was like, whoa. Your salvation doesn't depend on what you think of you.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
It depends on what Jesus and God think of you.
Amen.
Now he goes into what condemnation is. This is the condemnation.
Yeah.
Remember, Jesus is talking to Nicodemus about the new birth. You don't want to lose sight of what that's the context of all these statements. He's going to focus on the condemnation, showing that it's a just condemnation. It's not like a knee-jerk reaction to something men did. God doesn't speak hasty. See, men, that's it. See, God doesn't speak like this. This is not the way he is. It's going to be based on man's choice of darkness or light. This is the condemnation. This is the judgment. The NIV says this is the verdict. It's a pretty good. This is the verdict. This is the test by which men are judged, basic Bible English. Christian Standard Bible. This is the basis for judgment. God's Word Bible. This is why people are condemned. This is the ground of their condemnation, Murdoch Bible. Their sentence is based on this fact, the Living Bible. This is the crisis we're in, the Message Bible. The basis of the judgment or indictment, the test by which men are judged, the ground of the sentence, the Amplified Bible says. So he's going to say, now this, he spoke of condemnation, that's a strong word. So now this, he's going to tell you what moved that decision to be made, condemned. All right, the first part of it is light is coming to the world.
Yeah.
New King James Version says light has come into the world. Christian Standard Bible says light came into the world. New Living Translation says God's light came into the world. Living Bible says the light of heaven came into the world. Message Bible says the God light streamed into the world. Now the different versions represent actually three different views. Mm-hmm. One is the past tense, came into the world. Another is a present tense, is come into the world. The other is the sense that it came to stay, has come. Mm-hmm. And that's all three views are correct. Light made an entrance into the world. Mm-hmm. It did it in the past.
Uh-huh.
But it came to stay.
Yes.
Now, Jesus is the light of the world. He ascended up into heaven, but before he left,
yes,
he told his disciples, you are the light of the world.
Yes,
see,
exactly.
He left the light here.
Uh-huh.
He left the light here, dispersed among his people.
Yeah.
Now are ye light in the Lord.
That's
see,
right. Yeah.
The fact that light's in the world condemns those who don't receive it.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yeah, the mere presence of the light is what brought this condemnation.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And it's I can illustrate it like this. Let's say you were doing a long mathematical equation, okay, and you got to the end of it and your answer was wrong. But you didn't know why. So you work backwards and
yeah,
then, oh, you discover your mistake. Now, that the light of knowing that mistake has condemned
the
error.
That's right.
See, as soon as the light comes, the error is condemned already.
That's right, already.
Mm-hmm.
Already. Light is coming to the world. The Word is made flesh and dwelt among us. And the after effects of that are still with us. There's illumination.
Mm-hmm.
God has revealed the condition of man and the purpose of God.
Yes, amen.
A person's got to be able to put these two together. Here's the state I'm in, and here's what God has done about it.
Mm-hmm.
And here's what you can now, because God knew the state we're in and did something about it, now you can do something.
Yeah.
Something about it. Commensurate with the ministry of Jesus, the thoughts of men were made known. Remember, Simeon said that he was set for the rise and fall of many, and many that the thoughts of many might be revealed. This light. Let me tell you, if you shine for Jesus, or let your light shine for Jesus, some people's thoughts will surface. They'll say things, sometimes it'll surprise you,
yeah,
that they said what they said. You had no idea they were so corrupt.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
What made that happen? Light.
Yep. Amen.
Light made that happen. See, what it should have made them do is say, tell me about,
yes, amen,
why you live the way you do.
Yeah,
that it should have provoked that.
Amen.
Light is coming to the world. This is moral and spiritual light. It sheds illumination on right and wrong.
Mm-hmm.
accepted and unaccepted, righteous and unrighteous. See, we've had enough of man assessing humanity. We've really had enough of this. I've had enough of it myself, I can tell you. Man assessing humanity. They look at it and they comment on the flawed conduct. And they talk about the breakdown of the family. And the waywardness of youth and the weakness of the human government and the enslavement of men to certain types of conduct. That's human assessment. Mm-hmm. Now at that level, nothing can be resolved. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All you can do is band-aid work. That's all you can do.
Right.
You can't stop the bleeding. You can't change the nature. Now you can gripe all you want about government. It ain't going to change anything. You can't even go down and march against abortion down here. It's not going to change anything. Yeah. People got to see this. You say, well, you see, you shouldn't do that. I'm not saying that. I'm saying it's one of those so what things. Mm-hmm. That you have to have some power behind you.
Yeah.
You have to have more than a sign for the thing to change.
That's right.
Yeah. Light is coming to the world. It shed light on this condition. When they saw Jesus, hey, they weren't going to the Pharisees and scribes anymore. People that saw what he did. They didn't bring their sick to the Pharisees. They didn't bring their sick into the temple before Jesus came. Huh? Some Pharisee was traveling up in the hills. They didn't bring their sick to him. But when the light came into the world, people for the first time saw somebody that could do something about their condition.
Amen.
See, that's what we sorely desire. Mm-hmm. That's what we want to happen. We want them to be persuaded that Jesus can do something about their condition. That's believing in his name. See, that's what it does.
How long those 10 lepers were waiting in the bushes of the trees.
Oh, yeah.
When Jesus came, they saw him somehow. They heard news that he was coming along that way, and they waited there. Hid themselves and came out and pleaded with him.
Oh, amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
They weren't waiting for anybody else.
They weren't disappointed, were they?
No.
Amen. See, by nature, the difficulty with men is that they're alienated from God. Mm-hmm. They're dead in trespasses and sins. They're vassals of the devil. By nature, they're foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving diverse lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. But if you ask people if that's what they are, they will generally deny. They'll say, well, some of that, you know, some of that may be true, but but when the light shines, people know. That's why they flee to Jesus for refuge, to lay hold on the hope set before them. That's why they run to Jesus. That's why they've seen what they are. I'm afraid that there's a lot of preaching that doesn't expose people for what they are. All right, this is why they're condemned. Light came into the world that destroyed any ambiguity or ignorance about the condition. But men love darkness rather than light.
Yeah.
Men enjoyed sinning.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
They liked it.
Yeah.
They liked not thinking about God.
Uh-huh.
They liked it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They rather enjoyed not having Jesus pop into their thinking.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. They liked that. They enjoyed it. They felt comfortable at a distance from God. Isaiah said he was unanimously rejected of men. It wasn't because he was good. He wasn't rejected because he healed people.
That's right. Uh-huh.
He wasn't rejected because he calmed storms.
Uh-huh.
He was rejected because he exposed what the people were.
Yeah, amen.
That's why he was rejected.
Yeah.
Rejected of men. At the most crucial hour, even his disciples forsook him.
That's right.
Hmm? Because even at that time, they didn't know as fully as they would know who Jesus was.
Yeah.
One of the disciples said to Jesus, We thought he was the one.
That's right.
See? Light came into the world, but they hadn't seen it yet.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
But Jesus was patient with them, I'll tell you.
Yes.
Their state changed because Jesus chose them.
Amen.
The disciples forsook him, but they came back.
That's right.
Because God chose them, and then Jesus committed them into God's care. Yeah. Remember that?
Uh-huh. Yes.
He committed them into his care, and God kept those disciples from plummeting down the precipice of unbelief.
That's right.
They were discouraged.
Yes.
They were sad. They were confused, but they didn't quit believing.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Because they were chosen,
yes,
and God kept them.
Yeah.
Now, you can count on this happening. There are some people very, very weak in the faith. Some are by reason of they haven't been Christians very long, so that's why they are. But you can believe that God can keep them.
Yes, amen.
If they just got like a thimble of faith,
yes,
God can keep them till they grow up.
Uh-huh.
And you can encourage them and push them in that,
yes,
in that direction. But if they love darkness rather than light, the stamp condemned.
Yeah.
How do you know they love darkness? Because they preferred it.
Uh-huh.
They stayed in it when they didn't have to. Well, they were a long time getting in that state. They're going to be a long time coming out. No, that's not the truth.
No.
You can be in the grave. Jesus was in the grave 3 days, 3 nights. He came out.
Yep.
Wasn't part of the environment. Men would have had no objection to Jesus if he didn't shine.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. They'd probably made him a king. They were going to make him king. Let's make him king. We want a king like this. Give us free bread. I mean,
yes,
heal all our sick.
Mm-hmm.
Let's make him king. See? That's people because their deeds are evil.
Yeah. Yeah.
They love darkness rather than light. Why did they prefer darkness? Because what they were doing was evil.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they liked it.
Mm-hmm.
They liked it. The serial killer Ted Bundy, he liked killing women.
Mm-hmm.
32 of them.
Mm-hmm.
He liked it.
Mm-hmm.
That's why he did it.
Yep.
Hmm?
That's right.
Other people that have, from that atrocious type of conduct to people that are drunk all the time. Why are they drunk all the time? Because they like it. It's not necessarily because they have feelings of euphoria, but they forget all their troubles and they're
mm-hmm.
cast into a stupor, and the things that bother them don't bother them when they're all stupid because they're drunk. But the stamp condemned.
Yeah, that's right.
Hmm?
Right.
They love darkness rather than light. Condemned.
Yes.
I imagine if you could have talked to that Gadarene demoniac, if he ever did have a lucid period of time, and it appears he didn't, I don't think he would have told you that he liked cutting himself or being chained up.
Yeah.
But there are people that sin is addictive.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Didn't like it. Their deeds were evil. Their works, deeds, and actions were evil and wicked. Why were some of them look like they were good?
Uh-huh. Yes.
Because they weren't God-centered. You are basically an attempt to please self, not to please God. And efforts to please self, compared to pleasing God, are evil.
Yeah.
They're wicked. It's wrong for somebody God created to live for themselves.
Yeah.
This is wrong. It's logically wrong.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
And particularly since they've been purchased, on top of that, they've been created and they are purchased.
Uh-huh.
It's wrong.
Yeah.
Their deeds are evil.
Amen.
But some people prefer to live for themselves.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They prefer to make their own agendas. And for this reason, That's why they love darkness, because darkness permits you to make your own decisions and draw up your own agendas. See, darkness permits you to do this, but it causes you to be condemned and to refuse the light that came into the world and is still glowing in the world.
Amen.
Well, when people don't turn to the Lord, it's not because they don't understand. It's because they do understand. They sense down deep that to follow Jesus means I have to quit this, I can't do that. They've already worked this out in their minds. See, they know. By what little they know about God, what little they know about Christ, they know they can't continue to live like they do. But they want to live like they do. So they're condemned already. I think that's all I'll have for tonight. Any of you have a word you'd like to add? Yes, Brother Jason.
Yeah, when light comes into the room, the darkness can't stay.
That's right.
So it's not like that darkness and light can kind of coexist. Mm. They can't really coexist. Once the light comes, it changes. The room or the environment. Yeah. The world will never be the same, says Jesus.
Yeah, amen.
That's right.
See, but people can prefer it the way it was.
Yeah.
That's right.
It's like when some new revelation comes, see, you can't really change the fact that it's come. Mm-hmm. That knowledge is there.
Mm-hmm.
But see, people can prefer the way it was before that came.
Yeah.
And this is not acceptable. God's going to judge people. Because light came to them,
yes,
and they chose to not prefer it, to prefer the way it was before.
That's right.
That's God's going to judge people on that basis.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen.
You know, sometimes that light that comes to them will be in the form of maybe somebody will get a job in the same place you're at, and they'll bring Christ in the room with them. They'll bring them right. They'll bring the light right in the room.
Yeah.
But you don't light. It's like, what? For some reason, you just don't like that person. Well, let's see, this is this condemnation. The reason why they didn't like Jesus is the same reason they don't like you, if your light's shining.
Yeah.
Some people just will hate you, but you let your light shine, and in the end, you'll be the basis for their condemnation, because they saw something about Christ, but they denied it.
Mm. Anyone else tonight? All right, Mr. Barb, we're ready for you.